Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Sayukta from Beautiful Spotless Skin team. Viewers, obesity is a complex disease involving an excessive amount of body fat. Obesity isn't just a cosmetic concern. It's a medical problem that increases the risk of other diseases and health problems such as heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, and certain cancers as well. More than 1.9 billion adults are overweight and 650 million are obese. Approximately 2.8 million deaths are reported as a result of being overweight or obese, and in India, more than 135 million individuals were affected by obesity. There are many reasons for a person to become obese. Causes like sedentary lifestyle, hereditary, poor nutrition, and side effects of any medication are likely to contribute to obesity. Managing obesity consists of weight loss via consuming prescribed diet and increasing physical exercise, and maintaining that is very difficult. There are different techniques along with diet and physical exercise that most of the people are not aware of. So let's connect today with our expert, Dr. Jay Kumar Pillai, live from Tiruvalla, Kerala. Dr. Jay is consultant dermatologist and trichologist. He completed his post-graduation from KIMS Hospital, Bangalore. He has been an individual of merit during his academic career. Doctor is certified as liposculptor dermatosurgeon. Today, we are here to get aware about excessive fat deposition and obesity, shaping the way forward with basal liposuction and different techniques. A very warm welcome to you, Dr. Jay Kumar, and a very happy Doctor's Day to you as well, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you for having me and letting me speak on this topic, which is very close, which I'm very well connected to, and I'm very well fond of. And I hope that I can create some amount of awareness with this talk to the listeners.
Yeah, we are sure that we'll have a very informative and constructive discussion during this session. Now, as today we are going to talk about a very big concern that we Indians, and it's across all over the countries, it's obesity. So first of all, Dr. Jay, we would like to know what obesity is. How do we define obesity?
Yeah, so if we want to define obesity, it can be simply put in terms like this. Obesity simply means the deposition of fat in a person's body, right? Making him unhealthy, possessing health risk to that particular individual, right? So a good indicator of obesity, there are multiple indicators of obesity. A good indicator is body mass index, something known as BMI. Right, so which determines a person's basal metabolic rate and taking into consideration the height, weight, and age and sex, everything. So obesity basically means higher BMI, which poses health risk to that particular individual, making him prone to develop many other health issues. Right, so if you consider smoking and alcoholism risk factor for developing multiple other benefits, you should consider a high obesity also, which makes a person prone to develop many other health issues, right? So, so one quantification is we can divide the patients on the basis of body mass index. That is, a person's weight should be according to his height, right?
Right. So this is what obesity is, right? We would also like to know what are the causes responsible for obesity, obesity occurs.
Okay. So obesity can be due to multiple reasons, but the first and foremost, I have to stress on the fact that much in relation to the lifestyle what we are living in, right? As you rightly pointed out in the beginning, it is very prevalent among our population, particularly in our part of the world, in Asians, right? And it is a silent troublemaker, considered as a silent killer also. Okay, if the person has a high obese, he can get life expectancy is also getting reduced, right? So it is very prevalent in our population. It is a kind of silent epidemic which has struck our population way before Corona did, right? So what are the causes of obesity? Yes, first and foremost, diet and our lifestyle. Okay, whatever we intake, whatever we put inside our body, that comes into play, and how much we are physically moving, how much we are burning it, that also comes into play. So obesity results because of the change in these factors. Okay, putting in more inside our body rather than burning it or consuming it. So the excess amount gets deposited in the form of fat, and then you know, the vicious cycle takes in, right? So yeah, to put it simply, basically whatever we eat, okay, there is an energy value in it, which is known as the calories, right? So a body needs certain amount of calories to perform the bodily functions in a day, right? To just for us to live. And to move a bit or do any kind of physical exercise, the body needs some amount of energy. So if we put more calories into our body and we consume or burn very less amount of calories, the excess calories get stored in the body in the form of fat, right? The fat gets deposited in multiple compartments in our body, okay, which I'll be telling on later. So so this is how basically a person gets obese. So this is the first and the foremost reason why obesity happens. The second thing is any other health issues, like a medical condition like thyroid problem. If your thyroid hormone levels are low, again the person can become prone to get obese. And the use of certain medications, for example, you know, antipsychotic medications and all, can also lead to a person for obese. Okay,
right.
So these are the most common reasons.
Right. So now we know, you know, of course, mostly it's because of bad lifestyle, what we are eating and what we are not being able to burn, the calories that leads to obesity, plus other reasons are also, you know, there. We would also like to know, doctor, as you have mentioned, BMI, body mass index. Now, what are the various classes in obesity on the basis of BMI number?
Okay. So BMI as an indicator, it is not very specific, but it's a good, a cheap and easy indicator which can be accepted all over the world, right? It can be reproducible in every part of the world. You don't need any complex instruments for it. BMI basically is the weight of a person according to its height. Okay, so how you should weigh according to your height, that is what is body mass index is all about. The classification, as you asked, a person's BMI between 18 to 25 is considered as a healthy weight, right?
Okay.
Anything below 18 is underweight, and anything above 25 is overweight. And anything above 30 is obese. And there is another classification, that is anything above 40. Okay, that means the person is, if he or she is very short and is highly obese, it is considered as a class 3 obesity or morbidly obese. Now, morbid obese is something which should be considered as a, you know, or like a ticking bomb, right? So that kind of a person is, you know, prone for developing multiple health risks, right?
Right.
So this is the classification according to the BMI. Again, you can ask me, a very muscular person, a very heavyweight person who is a gym goer or a bodybuilder, he is also having a good weight, right? Because of the muscle mass. And that is because of the muscle mass, increased bone density. He can also have a good amount of weight, but he's not considered as overweight or obese. So that is why I said BMI is a good indicator, but it does not work everywhere.
Right. But we can say that if we falls under 18 to 25, we are good to go. Otherwise, you know, that's where we should be concerned about our body weight. We would also like to know, you very well said, doctor, that just like, you know, smoking and drinking alcohol, as we say, that it's injurious to our health and can actually lead to multiple, you know, things or problems in our body. In the same way, obesity is. Now, how obesity affect our overall health?
Okay. So, when fats get deposited in our body compartments, there are certain hormonal changes, there are certain physiological changes which takes place in our body. Okay. That leads to the development, or it kind of acts like a trigger to the development of many other health issues, right? So, the person can have a high body waist, body hip ratio. Okay, that leads to the development of type 2 diabetes mellitus, a high BP, that is hypertension, He can be prone for cardiac issues like coronary artery disease. High BP can also lead to stroke. Then the because of the huge weight which gets concentrated on the knee joints, he or she can develop arthritis, something known as osteoarthritis. Okay, muscle weakness, infertility, kidney ailments. So these are just a few of the side effects or the complications of being obese.
Right. And is it true that obesity can actually shorten life expectancy?
Yes, definitely. So as I mentioned earlier, being a morbid obese, where I mentioned class 3 obesity, is a very high risk factor for developing serious health issues, okay, like cardiac issues or stroke or stuff like that. So definitely, yes, it is true that obesity can decrease your life expectancy. So few researchers have even studied that a person who is morbid obese can live 10 years lesser than what he's supposed to live, right? So 10 years, the life expectancy got reduced. So that's why I mentioned, if you consider a chain smoking or a chronic alcoholism as a risk factor, you should also consider being obese in that same category, right? Because why? Because people are now generally aware of this, of the deleterious effect or the harmful effects of this particular condition.
So now we know that how, you know, bad obesity is for our overall health. Plus, it can actually shorten our life expectancy. So we actually need to address this as a serious issue. Doctor, now we would like to discuss, can obesity be cured?
So it most definitely can be cured, can be treated. Okay, the lifestyle can be reversed. Okay. So let me tell you what happens is that once you get in that comfort zone, the body gets into that comfort zone where it is very difficult to come out of it. Okay, when you are eating too much or we are doing very little of physical movement, the body tends to like that. Okay, and it is very difficult to come out of it. But that's where the change happens. Okay, and that is how you can actually cure obesity. So I'll definitely tell all my patients, like, follow a healthy lifestyle, whatever is included, like a proper eating habit, physical movement, behavioral changes, practicing meditation and getting adequate sleep, 8 hours of sleep and everything. This will actually what cures obesity. If you don't have any other medical condition and all, this healthy lifestyle will actually cure obesity, right? So controlling your diet, doing a regular physical exercise at least maybe 30 to 40 minutes per day, 5 days a week, and practicing good sleep, practicing meditation, these are all the changes which you can make in your daily routine which can actually cure obesity. But the initial change is what is very difficult, and that's where we all should work upon.
Doctor, we all know that if we have a heart concern, we should go to a cardiologist. If I have a bladder or, urinary tract related issue, I'll go to a neurologist. But which doctors we need to consult for obesity?
Okay, fine. So, as I mentioned earlier, instead of consulting a doctor, I think you should consult a nutritionist expert first of all, or try implementing these changes first, right? Hit a gym. Start going to the gym. Consult a fitness expert. Try implementing all those exercises. Try changing your diet plan and everything. Of course, for that we can also help. You can consult a dermatologist like myself. You can consult a plastic surgeon. Hello.
Yes, doctor.
Yeah, you can hear me, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Fine. So these are the doctors which you can consult. Okay, so the first and foremost, I will tell to change the lifestyle. And of course, you don't need a doctor for that. Okay, you have access to all this information on social media and everywhere. Okay, you can try implementing all those things. And if it is not working, if it is becoming cumbersome, or if you're not physically able to implement all those changes, yes, as healthcare providers, we can interfere in that. Mm-hmm. Okay. And we can guide the patient accordingly.
Right. We all know, doctor, as a fact that obesity is not good. It will hamper our, you know, overall health. We all know that there are ways we can actually be fit. But then it's actually really tough, you know. I would also like to ask you in this regard, is there any natural remedy to treat obesity?
Okay. So the only natural remedies with which you can treat obesity is, in fact, improving your lifestyle, right? Mm. So tracking your diet, monitoring your diet, okay. Moving around, physical movement, as I mentioned, okay, exercising, and then practicing good sleep, okay. Take plenty of water. So these are all the natural remedies of controlling the fat levels. Okay, to give just an example, try monitoring your diet like this. You can change from simple sugars to more complex carbohydrates. Okay, so you can cut off the white rice, you can cut out the white sugar, the white bread, replace it with brown bread, brown rice, and stuff like that. Okay, right. Consume very little of sugary foods. Okay, that is a simple carbohydrate, because your body, your mind needs a lot of glucose, so it actually tricks you into taking a lot of sugars. Okay, so many researchers do suggest that sugar is more addictive than many of the drugs which are available. So that kind of effect sugar has on your body. Okay, so cutting on that sugars, cutting on that fast food, junk food. Okay, unhealthy fats. These can do wonders for your body shape and everything. Okay. And then, of course, as I mentioned, exercising in a daily manner. Okay. Not just once in a week and all. In a daily manner, mm-hmm. if you exercise 30 to 40 minutes a day, definitely you can improve your body shape and can prevent all many health issues.
Right. So a healthy lifestyle is the mantra. You need to eat well. Just okay. Check what you are eating, what you are drinking, and again, exercise. Burn it out. That's really important. Okay. And in case the natural remedies or, you know, lifestyle modifications are not helping, what are the treatment options, doctor, that, you know, are recommended for obesity?
Sure. So in many patients who come to me, they have some kind of obstacles ahead in front of leading a healthy lifestyle, right? Okay, either they're living alone or they're very much workaholic, they're not getting time and stuff like that. Okay, so I always tell my patient, I counsel them to the fullest. Okay, to try changing lifestyle, and if it is not working, we can definitely intervene, okay, surgically. So in our case, we as a facility in our center, we have a group of doctors, okay, combining dietitians, nutritionists, fitness expert, family physician, okay, we all work in bringing body transformation, right? And if none of them that are acting, we can always opt for a surgical procedure that is simply remove fat from the body compartment, which is known as liposuction. So that is this is one surgical procedure which we can perform in patients to get rid of obesity. And highly obese, we don't prefer doing liposuction because that doesn't work in such kind of patients. We advise them to go for a bariatric surgery.
Okay. I would also like to tell our viewers that Dr. Jayakumar is a certified member of Fournier & Field Liposuction Group, and he has completed almost 700 body shaping surgeries till date, which is a very good statistic. Doctor, as we are talking about liposuction, I would like to... Yes, as we are talking about liposuction, I would like to know, where is liposuction be performed? I mean, in which body parts we can do liposuction?
Okay. So let me just explain you like this. Whenever excess calorie is there in our body. The body stores is it has fat. Okay, the fat is stored in. It can get stored just beneath our skin. That is known as subcutaneous fat. Okay, something which we can pinch. Okay, and it can also get deposited inside our body. For example, inside the muscle layer around the internal organ. Now that is known as visceral fat. Okay. So these are the two kinds of fat, that is the subcutaneous fat and the visceral fat. So liposuction is amenable to removal of only subcutaneous fat. Okay. So whatever is pinchable, we can remove it. So we can only perform this this small easy test at our home. We can just pinch our required area. For example, if you are worried about the tummy, you can just pinch it. If you can grasp it between your fingers, that is your skin and that is your subcutaneous fat layer. Okay, you're not holding onto the muscle because muscle is something which is deep inside. So that fat layer is obstructing that muscular layer. So above the muscle layer, there is a subcutaneous layer, and that kind of subcutaneous fat layer we can remove through liposuction. The second deposit of fat, that is the visceral fat. In that case, liposuction doesn't work. Okay, we can't remove visceral fat. For that, you have to follow the lifestyle changes as I mentioned. If it is not acting, you have to do a surgical intervention like a bariatric surgery, as I mentioned. Okay.
Okay. So, doctor, in case one wants to know whether he or she is an ideal candidate for the procedure or liposuction, I mean, the pinching activity is the only thing, or there are other ways also, or as a doctor, how do you make out that he or she is an ideal candidate for the procedure?
Yeah. So, according to me, an ideal candidate for liposuction is a person who is at least moderately active in his lifestyle. Okay, and he is controlling or monitoring his intake in the form of food. Okay, so that kind of a person is ideal for liposuction, who wants to get rid of that resistant fat. Okay, so even after you follow all these lifestyle changes and all, there can be stubborn and resistant fat deposited around the maybe belly region, okay, maybe the love handles, the sides, okay,
yes.
Arms in females, and then double chin in males. These are the various regions where maybe the lifestyle changes won't be successful. Okay, so in that case, we can actually think of doing liposuction. Okay.
Okay, and one question I'm sure all the viewers must be having in their mind: is liposuction surgery safe?
Okay, so see, as I mentioned, liposuction is basically just removal of fat beneath your skin. Okay, so the kind of liposuction what we in our center what we perform is something known as vaser liposuction. Okay, which basically means we are melting the fat and we are removing it in a liquid form. Okay, so the traditional liposuction, like the conventional liposuction, aims at removing the fat in a dry form. Okay. So that doesn't involve melting away the fat and all. Okay, so that kind of liposuction was actually a little bit more crude. Okay, it was associated with much more like longer hospital stays and complications and bleeding and stuff like that. Okay, so vaser liposuction is one of the most advanced method of liposuction what we follow, and comparatively the complications and the side effect profile is very less. Okay, so the patient can have a lesser hospital stay, lesser complications. The melting only happens in the fat compartment, the surrounding tissues doesn't get damaged. So liposuction is one of the most common cosmetic surgeries performed worldwide. Okay, many of us are not aware of that. That is because it is a minimally invasive surgery. Minimally invasive means it is not causing any trauma to the other structures. Okay, and obviously it's a surgical procedure, so some amount of side effects you can experience, right? That is unavoidable. You can expect swelling, you can expect bruising, you can expect a little bit of fluid collection in the treated areas, a little bit of hardness in the treated areas, unevenness. So all these are quite controllable and quite manageable. And if the patients follow all the post procedure instructions, many of these can be definitely be avoided.
Okay, and it's temporary, these side effects like swelling, etc.
So whatever the side effects which I mentioned, okay, all these are surgical related side effects. Okay,
right.
It's not long term. It's not going to stay there forever. Hmm? So maximum maybe a week or 10 days you can expect these. Okay, the bruising, the swelling, the cuts. So it's a keyhole surgery. Okay, we make small incision in the skin and then we remove the fat in a liquid form from that hole. Okay, so that hole draining will be there in the initially 2 to 3 days. Means a little bit of liquid will be coming out in the initial 2 to 3 days. So these are all the usual procedure related after effects. I can't say side effects of it. Okay, which is totally controllable, and of course the patient should be counseled regarding the procedure and what to expect, and he should be well and thoroughly explained how you should deal with the post-op side effects and everything.
Right. Doctor, what kind of preparation that patients need to be done before liposuction surgery? Any preparation from the patient's side?
Preparations as such from the patient's point of view?
Yes.
Okay. Fine. So, particular in the patient doesn't have to do anything in particular. Okay. I'll tell you about my center. In our facility, the patient, we call the patient 1 day prior to the surgery. Okay. And, we make the patient, comfortable, get adjusted, get comfortable with the surrounding, and atmosphere. Okay, 1 day prior to the surgery. Okay. Preparations as such, we have to look upon few of the things. Okay, if he's on any medications, if he's having any other health issues. Okay, so we have to consult with the respective doctors and then take their opinion also before doing the surgery. And then, as such, we have to try for any, we have to look for any medicine reactions and all by giving small test doses. So these are all the preparations which are done from our side. Okay.
Right.
From the patient side, they should be mentally prepared. They should be calm. They should not be panicky, which again adds to the problem during the surgery. Okay. So this is what the patient should expect, and they should have a realistic expectation from the procedure.
Exactly. That's important. And is it a painful procedure, or is there any pain after the procedure? I mean, you have already spoken about the side effects, potential side effects, but other than that?
So, yeah, I get this question a lot. Okay. So, many people come and ask me the fat is an essential component of the body. How can you just remove it? Won't
exactly.
there be a problem? So yeah, that's what I had mentioned earlier in the discussion. So whatever we consume, whatever calories we consume, we are storing it for future. Okay. Whatever we are not burning it off, we are storing it for the future. The body is tricking into storing it for future. Hmm? The body thinks that this person might be starving in future, might do a lot of physical exercise in future. So let me store this fat as energy so that I will utilize it for the future. Hmm. But we don't reverse this cycle. We don't end up utilizing it, and we end up actually increasing the thickness more and more. Okay, so this is a vicious cycle what happens. So whatever subcutaneous fat you have, okay, that is all mostly unwanted fat. Okay. Okay, so these are the fat which we haven't used over the years. So removing that doesn't cause a problem. Okay. And second thing you said is about the pain. So the procedure is as such painless. Okay. Not about the conventional liposuction. What we perform, the vaso liposuction is absolutely painless. Okay. The procedure, we numb the area completely, whichever area we are targeting, we numb the area completely. And then post-op also, there is not much pain. There can be mild discomfort. I can definitely tell that because, as I said, it's a keyhole surgery. We are making small incisions. Okay.
Right.
So you can get a small amount of discomfort or pain in those areas. Okay. And if there is a swelling or a bruising, you can get pain in there. Okay. But those are all manageable or not a very you know, on a pain scale, it is not very high. Those are well controlled, well tolerated pain.
Right. Now, after the surgery, as I can see, you know, with liposuction, a layer of false fat is gone. Now, is this effect permanent, or there are chances that the person will accumulate, you know, the fat again in that area?
Right. So, I always tell all my patients who undergo liposuction from me that this is not a license to lead a healthy lifestyle from now onwards. Okay. So do follow a healthy lifestyle. I urge them to follow. Okay. If they haven't done so till now. Okay. Even after the procedure, do follow a healthy lifestyle, control your intake. Okay. Monitor your intake. Okay. So we give them a structured diet plan according to their needs and their calorie intake and everything. So they should follow it regularly. Okay. Yes. Of course, once in a while they can take a break. They can have a, you know, party, and they can do a cheat day and everything. But again, the next day they should compensate for that, either in the form of exercise or less intake. So leading a healthy lifestyle is very important even after the surgery. Okay. So it is not a license to eat whatever you want. So this is how the results of liposuction also comes out. Okay. So if I perform a liposuction today in a patient, there will be drastic improvement tomorrow. Okay. But the actual result will come only after 2 to 3 months of surgery. Okay. When the patient follows all the things which I have properly explained to them. Right. So right. Post-op surgical instructions are very important to follow.
Right. So these are the things that the patient or the person needs to follow after the liposuction procedure is done. Now, one more thing, and I'm sure all our viewers are, you know, eager to know this. How much will the treatment cost for liposuction?
Okay. So so this is a very variable question. We can't give a we can't comment on the exact thing. So in our center, in our facility, we charge according to the weight of the patient and the area what he or she wants to correct. Okay. So if there are multiple areas involved, again the cost of the procedure goes high. Okay. So I am aware of the fact there are many cheaper rates which are available in the market, but mostly of them are performing traditional liposuction. Okay. So when the technology is advancing, more innovations are coming, the procedure charge also goes high. Okay. So ultimately the weight of the patient and the area of the patient and the post-op care, everything depends like this. These are all factors which depends, which make the cost of the procedure.
Yes, we completely understand that. Doctor, we'll also take some of our viewers' questions. Vijayana Modi is asking, what is personalized nutrition and what is it used for?
Okay. So, as I mentioned, BMI, body mass index, okay, it is dependent on many factors. You can't just generalize it for everyone. Okay. For older people above 65 years of age, it is different. Okay. You can't use the same scale. For children, it is different. Okay. These scale doesn't work in them also. So BMI should be calculated according to the, the weight of the patient, the height, the basal metabolic rate should be calculated according to the height, weight, the sex of the patient, the age of the patient, his or her lifestyle choices. Okay. How active he is, moderately active, lightly active. So all this comes into play. Okay. So this is how you calculate a customized nutrition plan, a customized by knowing your basal metabolic rate.
Okay. Shivendra Singh is asking, is it better to completely avoid saturated fats from our diet, or we necessarily need some of it?
Okay. Saturated fats, it is better to avoid saturated fats. Okay. Because it is mostly unhealthy in our diet. Okay. The unsaturated fats, that is polyunsaturated fats, is what we require. That is, most of it is omega fatty acids. Okay. Stuff like that. So these are the healthy fats. And the other ones are basically the bad fats, which you should avoid in your diet.
Right. Doctor, can you give some of the examples for our viewers who do not understand the difference between saturated and unsaturated and, you know, what food items fall under which category?
Yeah, saturated fats is something, okay, if chemically we are speaking, the saturated fats, like there are no chemical bonds in it, okay, left, okay. The unsaturated fats, there are bonds, chemical bonds which are left, okay. So if I tell it in a form of diet, polyunsaturated fatty acids are omega fatty acids, okay, linolenic acid, oleic acid, which you can find in, you know, fish, salmon, you know, sardine, stuff like that, flax seeds, sprouts. So all these are unsaturated fatty acids, which the body needs. Okay.
Right.
Which is very important for cellular function, to preventing inflammation. Okay. And preventing many other health risks. Saturated fatty acids is what you get from, you know, fast food, junk food, oils and everything.
Right. So this is how we can, you know, differentiate and understand why unsaturated is what we need to include in our diet and why it's important to omit saturated fats. Asha Jan is asking, can obesity lead to cancer?
Yes, obesity can lead to cancer. There are many reports which suggest that liver cancer and endometrial cancer can be related to obesity. Okay. So when you are obese, much of the fat that also can get deposited over in the liver. Okay. Something known as fatty liver disease. Okay. Which could be alcoholic, which could not be alcoholic also. So if there is alcoholism, it again adds to the problem. So liver cancer can develop because of highly obese. And then there are many other reports of like endometrial cancer in females, and ovarian cancer can also come because of being highly obese.
Right. So it's important to manage your weight. It's important to stay healthy. Priya Sharma is asking, does maternal obesity pose a risk to the mother or the child?
No. See, during the pregnancy, a healthy weight gain of 11 to 12 kilograms is actually allowed. Okay. So that's where I mentioned the BMI is subjective. Okay. Pregnant woman also, the scale could not be applicable. Okay. So healthy weight gain of 11 to 12 kilograms during the female, during the pregnancy is quite normal, and you can't comment on the obesity part of it.
Right. Rohama David is first of all wishing you a very happy Doctor's Day. And question is, does a low calorie diet help in losing weight?
Okay. So instead of going for a low calorie diet, you should always maintain a calorie deficit is what I will suggest. Okay.
Okay.
You should eat what is necessary. That is understandable. You have to perform the bodily functions. Okay. You can't get devoid of nutrients and minerals and everything that could lead to many other problems, right? Like hair fall, skin changes and everything. Okay. So always maintain a calorie deficit is what I will tell you. Okay. So an average person might need around 2000, 2500 calories per day. Okay. So if you eat less than that and also burn more calories, okay, by physical movement and everything, and then creating a calorie deficit is actually going to help you. Okay. Rather than not eating very, like maintaining your calorie level at a very low amount. Okay. Eat
right.
Healthy, eat properly and maintain a calorie deficit. That will help you more.
Yeah, because nowadays, there's a lot of, you know, diets are in trend where people
right.
are fasting more and, you know, otherwise
right.
they are on liquid diets. So,
right.
so it's important
I
to
won't...
eat well.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Aradhana Malviya is asking, is obesity genetic? Can obesity be genetic?
Not really. Okay. I won't comment on that. But, you know, usually a person, a couple who is more overweight can have babies who are on the like higher weight category. But it is totally reversible. Okay. There's nothing like it runs in families and it is not well at all. Okay. By doing all the above things, whatever I've mentioned, definitely weight can be reduced. Okay. So there's nothing like the obesity is genetic and it continues. We can't do anything about it.
Okay. And doctor, now as we are moving towards the conclusion part, any takeaway note for our viewers?
Okay. So by this live session, all I wanted to convey is that like creating some amount of awareness about this this troublemaker that is being overweight or being obese, right? So people are still not aware of the health risk it poses. And also, if you do consult your nearby dermatologist or a plastic surgeon, if you think like whatever you're doing is not working out, okay, you can always get a consultation, get advice from a healthcare provider. Okay, actually, all these happens in a controlled manner. Okay, where multiple healthcare providers can combine and give you results. Okay, take the help of a nutritionist, take the help of a physical expert, take the help of a dermatologist. All of them will play a role in it. Okay, but in the end, lead a healthy lifestyle. Okay, eat properly. Okay, do exercise a lot. Take healthy diet and everything. Drink plenty of water. Sleep for eight hours a day. I think that's more than enough.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Jaikumar Pillai. It was wonderful talking to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you for having me. Thank you.
Like, subscribe, and press the bell icon. Thanks for watching.